From the Foundation Studio right here on Biloxi's Back Bay, welcome to SuperTalk Outdoors, where we celebrate every single Monday at lunchtime. The world-class outdoors of the state of Mississippi, because as I say every single week, we are the capital of the outdoors in America, and I'll stand toe-to-toe with anyone else anywhere in the country. Just come on down, and I've got too many arrows in my quiver on that argument. Anyway, we're the capital of the outdoors. I want to thank you for joining us on the powerful SuperTalk Mississippi Radio Network, or on SuperTalk TV at C Spire TV. But if you're listening on YouTube or Facebook or your favorite podcast, it's January the 23rd, 2023. It's the last week, for the most part, except in the southern zone, last week of deer hunting season and duck hunting season. My friend Mark Creech and Travis Dunn, my farmer buddy up in the Mississippi Delta, sent a great picture this morning of a duck hunt they had this morning on Travis's farm. It's great to see some birds. You know, the duck report across Mississippi has been a little spotty. Some areas it's been good. Some areas it's been not so good, but then it got good again. You know, it's been a strange season. Started out with that really cold blast. We thought, uh-oh, this is a really good harbinger of what's to come. But then we had warm weather, and you know the story. We also didn't have a lot of water to start out with, but then we have plenty of water now, which is obviously spreading the ducks out. But anyway, I hope everybody's having a great hunting season and that you're staying safe. And as you know, I harp on the safety piece every single show. That's how I close every single show. We can never put safety up there enough. The notes I get from people, incidentally, about that, man, there are a lot of close calls in this state that don't result in injuries. But man, oh man, it's amazing how when you get excited in the moment, you forget your gun is loaded. And it can lead to some really, really terrible things. So anyway, stay safe. Just stay safe. Hey, look, I am so thrilled today to have a really good friend of mine. His name is Reed Guice. I'm going to bring Reed in, and then we'll talk more about Reed here in just a second. But Reed, good morning to you, my friend.
Hey, good morning from down around the bend in Biloxi's Back Bay. I'm out here right now just looking at how low this tide is. We've had some extremely low tides. Most of the bay is gone right now.
Yeah, and look, there's been some speckled trout in Back Bay. But so anyway, yeah, Reed lives near me on Biloxi's Back Bay. And we worked together when I was publisher of the newspaper, and even before that, we worked together in the community. He owned an extremely successful award-winning ad agency. And, you know, his dad was the famous civil defense director for Harrison County. Before, of course, and during and after Camille has been credited, his mother as well, I might add, credited with saving hundreds and hundreds of people as it relates to how they dealt with Hurricane Camille. But what we're going to be talking about with Reed today is fly fishing, because Reed is an accomplished fly fisherman, and I'll get into what all he's involved with there. But you know, at the top of the list, of course, he's a fly fishing international certified fly casting instructor. He owns a number of state records in Mississippi. Check this morning, Reed. You know, you've broke a bunch of records over the year. You still hold a bunch of records, and yep. I actually was surprised to see my son Jordan still has at least one fly fishing record, and then another all tackle record in the state of Mississippi. But we've had some fun times together, haven't we, my friend?
We have. We set two records on your boat. I remember the Big Bonita record and our Little Tony, they should be called, actually. And then the Almaco Jack. Let's not talk about how big the Almaco Jack
was. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. It was definitely a state record. But, you know, you heard me say, Reed, because, you know, you've traveled all over the world, literally. You fly fished everywhere. But I make this point every week that we're the capital of the outdoors in America. You go find certain aspects that are better in other areas, but collectively, you're not going to be able to go deer hunting and duck hunting in one morning, then go catch a tuna, and, you know, the next day offshore. There are very few places you're going to be able to do that. We're lucky to live here, aren't we, my friend?
You're exactly right. I mean, in normal times, I'd be able to just walk out my back door over there into the pier at night, and the speckled trout would be popping those little shrimp out of everywhere, and the big reds come through. And it's just brilliant. It really is. What a great place to live.
Because where you live on Back Bay and where I live on Back Bay, we can often look back, you know, back behind our houses and see boats back there kind of doing their thing. And, you know, we're lucky when Back Bay's right, which means we don't have a lot of rain because it's a watershed. And when it rains a lot, the salinity is going to be messed up. But when it's nice and clear and we've got good salinity, we don't have to go very far to catch fish, do we, buddy?
Exactly right. The travel from here is to go catch a different kind of fish.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, if you want to go catch trout, you know, I'm talking rainbows, cutthroats, goldens, those kind of trout, you have to go someplace else. But you can do it all right here.
Reed, I loved when you and I visited on my show, Coast View on the Coast, and we talked about a little bit about, you know, your whole life story, to be honest with you. But for people who know coastal Mississippi, even from North Mississippi, you've been down here. Most people know about Mary Mahoney's.
Oh yeah,
Mary Mahoney's, this famous French restaurant right there in Biloxi. And Bobby Mahoney's been on my show, Coast View, before, and a couple of times actually, and quite a character. But Reed was literally raised in what is now the parking lot for Mary Mahoney's. And I love to hear you talk about your pre-Camille days and what fishing was to you back in those days.
Oh, Ricky, it was incredible. I mean, just right there, across the street from me was a skating rink. But on the other side of that was the Mississippi Sound, the Gulf of Mexico. I could walk down to the small craft harbor in just a few minutes and just right around the corner. And I spent most of my summers there, barefoot, just a pair of shorts. And I didn't have really good fishing equipment, but I could always find some monofilament line, a little hook. And of course, baits everywhere. You know, you can see those dried shrimp. Catch yourself a croaker, and then you can go ahead and get some cut bait. And I just can remember so often laying down on my stomach with a piece of monofilament in my hand and catching fish. I didn't care what kind. I didn't care how big, just to catch fish.
Croakers, pinfish, catfish. You know, yeah. It's interesting. I don't know what it is. Maybe it's you know, getting back to our roots. There's something about getting a little hook on some monofilament line with your hand. We do it here. We have a little bay head that we walk across to get out to our pier, and the bull minnows and sometimes a small mullet get in there. And Jordan, if they're in there heavy, that's what he prefers to do in order to get bait. He'll go in there with his hand line and just lay on his stomach and just do it that way. And of course, he's taught the kids how to do it, but that is so much fun, isn't it?
And go get me some bait, kids. Wonderful. It's nothing like it. And it's the connection. It's just that connection of your nervous system with the nervous system of a fish, that jolt, you know, that you get it or they get it too. It's a lot of fun.
Listen, when you and I visited together, we talked about a couple of things that had come up. And I had recently seen an interview between Chris Stapleton and Joe Rogan. If you remember, what I said was they were talking about fly fishing, but they were literally having a hard time. They were just struggling with describing, you know, the art and culture of it. I mean, they knew they were experiencing something special, but they were having a really difficult time talking about it. And as you know, you and I, we fell in love with an author, Middleton, who wrote a great book called On the Spine of Time, about fly fishing up in the Smokies and North Carolina in that area. And you came to really appreciate, as I did over time, that fly fishing is literally an experience. It's an opportunity to be one with nature in a stream or on a boat, even if you're offshore or whatever. Explain what fly fishing means to you.
Well, let's go back to the beginning. I was talking about catching fish, you know, with a piece of monofilament line and a piece of dried out shrimp, and catching lots of them. I graduated from catching lots of fish to then wanting to catch big fish. And I did, you know, when you caught some nice speckled trout, you know, this is great. You know, live shrimp. I used to wade the beach. For years, I'd wade the beach with a bucket of live shrimp. And generally, I could catch a fisherman's dozen, which is 11, and then go get dressed and get back to work. But after you catch, you know, a lot of, you catch some more bigger fish, and you want to catch a lot of big fish. And we do that, you know, we go into Louisiana or other places and just load up on the speckled trout. But then eventually you want to do it a little differently. And that's where something like fly fishing comes in. Okay, I want to do it only with artificials.
Let's do this. Let's pick, we'll transition into fly fishing on the other side. Okay. But this is my friend Reed Guice. He is he's famous down here in coastal Mississippi. People know him well. I'll explain to you why they know him so well here in just a second. But we're talking about fly fishing. We'll see you on the other side.
Whistling that sweet soul for him. I said three Mississippi to this land called home. I'll breathe Mississippi till I'm dead and gone. Just carry on, I'll carry on. Mississippi.
Leading the conversation on Mississippi's outdoors.
It's Super Talk Outdoors with Ricky Matthews on Super Talk Mississippi. Mississippi.
Welcome back to Super Talk Outdoors. I'm talking to my good friend Reed Guice, who is an accomplished fly fisherman, and we're talking about fly fishing. And I mentioned before we went to break, you know, he's famous for a bunch of reasons. He's been involved in successful political campaigns. He's worked with some of the best and biggest companies here in coastal Mississippi with their marketing campaigns. He has a very famous friend that he fly fishes with. We'll talk a little bit more about that in a second. But one of the things I say about Reed often, I've said it on the show more than once, Reed is a guy who has a low threshold for amazement. In other words, he takes in the moment, he lives in the moment, and he is appreciative of everything that's happening in the moment. So if he sees a mockingbird, he'll go, man, that is an amazing mockingbird. If he sees the same mockingbird tomorrow morning and the sun's on it slightly different, he's still amazed by the same mockingbird. He loves the micro aspects of the world, and he appreciates every aspect of it. That's true, though, isn't it, Reed?
If you really stop and listen, you can't count how many different songs a mockingbird has. He'll go and go and go and make up stuff over and over and over again and finally hit one that the ladies like.
But I've always loved the way Jordan, my son, describes you as having a low threshold for amazement. I just think that's perfect. That's perfect. So anyway, when we went to break, you were talking about you start out with the hand line, and then you catch some bigger fish, and then you catch a lot of big fish, and then you made the transition to fly fishing. So pick it up from there.
After that, after you catch a lot of fish, a lot of big fish, you want to do it. You want to handicap yourself, son. So, okay, I'm just going to use artificials. That's all. No, I'm not a live bait guy anymore. People soak in worms and shrimp. I'm an artificial guy. And then you want to make it a little tougher. So you only use topwater baits, right? Those mirror lures and those devil's horses and the big old lucky 13s and stuff, when you catch them that way. Well, fly fishing is where you can really go over the deep end, Ricky. I mean, it's you can get it bad. Because then you say, okay, I'm going to catch them on a fly. And I started catching them as a youth with my dad in our local streams here. You're catching bluegill on brim bugs. I had no idea where it would lead later in life. And essentially that's to going out to chandelier and leaving all my other tackle behind and only taking a fly rod, me and my friend David Sheffield, and going out and coming back in at the end of the days with more fish than anybody else. That's it. It's over, you know?
That opened up an adventure around the world. And most of those adventures have included David Sheffield. So explain who your famous friend is.
Oh, David Sheffield, of course, from Biloxi, a Biloxi native. Went to Fernwood, graduated from Biloxi High, Ole Miss, and then USM. And David and I have been friends since we were youths. And he shares that love of fly fishing. We developed it on his beautiful 55-foot Kovacevic lugger, the Skipjack. We spent a lot of time out at Chandelier fly fishing for speckled trout and reds. Unfortunately, that boat's gone now. We lost it in Katrina. But yeah, we've been everywhere. We've been to, the first to Montana. Oh boy, Montana, beautiful. Then from there, we've been to California, Colorado, to Alaska, New Zealand, Patagonia. We fly fish literally, you know, around the world. And it's wonderful. It just is, you know, and you meet different people, different situations. All of it's good. It's all good.
But David, tell about his Saturday Night Live days. And yeah.
Yeah. David was working with me at the advertising agency, and he had a friend that was up in New York, and he said he had a chance to audition for Saturday Night Live too. And David sent him some material. And they said, well, you're okay, man, but who's writing that material? And so he wrote some more and sent it up there. We need to talk to this guy. And finally, a friend of his called up there and said, y'all looking for this guy? I know where to find him. And he went up there and they hired him. He went from Biloxi to Manhattan. I mean, overnight. Think of that. And went on to become head writer. Stayed there for a number of years until he and his writing partner, Barry Blaustein. But Barry and David, when they got there, there was a sort of a feature player. He wasn't a full member of the cast. That was Eddie Murphy. And they said, this guy's funny. Let's hook up with him. And then it went from there. You know, I mean, they've written all these great movies for Eddie Murphy. Coming to America 1 and 2, the Clumps, the whatever it is, you know, the Nutty Professor, just some great work. And he continues to write. He just finished, you know, Coming to America too.
Yeah, that's it. That's incredible. You know, David's and he, of course, he has a significant love for nature and the outdoors, and you guys really enjoy some times together. So coming back to when did you say I'm going to pursue some of these state records in fly fishing?
Oh, the day that they announced it. You kidding me? Oh, this is cool. Not that I want to show off. Okay. Yeah. But the day that it came in, when it was official that we're going to set these fly rod records, at 12:01, I went to the end of my pier. I caught a 14.5-inch speckle trout, took a picture of it, and turned it into DMR, and boom, there was your first fly fishing record in Mississippi. a lot of ribbing about that. The size. Yeah. Fish. It was a big photo of it in the newspaper. You know, what is he doing with that little fish?
I remember, Reed, you remember this too, but we were at the Isle of Capri. It was before Hurricane Katrina. You were being roasted in some community event.
Yeah.
And I remember that fish. And so what I did is I called one of our seafood market friends and said, I need a speckled trout that's this size. And I put it in an ice chest. And during my roast speech of you, I pulled this speckled trout out of the ice and held it up for everybody to see what Reed's state record looked like. Of course, in this big room, it was really tiny by the time you got, you know, we're looking from way in the back. But we had some real fun with that for sure. But the reality is, you know, if you do it the way that they say you have to do it, it's not a fait accompli that you're going to catch all these records. You gotta have some skill, too.
You do, and there's no cheating. You can't put any bait on the end of it. It's got to be a fly, and the real problem is getting to the fish. You know, I mean, the one record that I hold that has never been broken. I think I have three or four now, but the one that I don't know when it'll be broken was for spade fish of all things, and I just happened to be in a rig that was just totally loaded with spade fish and caught a really nice one. Took it in and entered a record. The same situation there, though. I was catching snapper. I set record after record on red snapper. And then later fishing under sargassum seaweed, you know, a record mai-mai, a triple tails. You know, it's all where you go. It's finding the right structure, finding the right kind of fish, and yeah, okay, a little skill.
Hey, so let's get back to, we got a couple of things I want to do is I want to talk about some about the process of the flies that you tie and the ones you use for your saltwater, the kind of rods that you like to use. But I want to come back a bit to on the spine of time in Middleton and the way he so almost like it's almost like this religious experience sit in that stream. Tell people about that sort of out-of-body experience that you have beyond just catching the fish.
Oh, it's something. And you remember in that the book, The River Runs Through It, the author, sorry, I can't remember his name now, he's brilliant, but the author said, in my family, there is no difference between fly fishing and religion. His father was a Presbyterian minister, and both were extremely serious in his family. And yes, you know, that one good thing, one of the nice things about fly fishing is that if you're casting well, you get into this rhythm, you're able to enjoy the surroundings, cast after cast. And even if you don't catch a fish, you can say, wow, that was a great cast. If there was a fish there, I would have caught him.
And you're watching all these species of insects that are flying around, and you're in your fly tying endeavors, you're wanting to try to mimic some of that stuff, but it's you're taking it all in, aren't you?
When you're fishing for trout like that, people make fun of me. I'm kind of crazy about bugs, you know. and it's not just the bug, it's the life cycle of the bug. Like a mayfly will go from being just a nymph crawling among the rocks on the ground. He'll then become an emerger, come up to the top of the, and then eventually when it breaks free and becomes a dry fly, you know, with the wings out, boom, you know, that's the dry fly. But most of these fish are eating under the surface, not on top. You got to know the insect and really in what phase that insect's in, what size it is, what color is it.
So when we come back, we'll talk a little bit more about the fly tying process and how he adapts that in the process. We're talking to my good friend Reed Guice, who's a Fly Fishing International certified fly casting instructor, but he's just a lover of fly fishing. We'll see you after this. Sweet soul for him. I sail three Mississippi to this land called home. I'll breathe Mississippi till I'm dead.
This is Super Talk Outdoors with Ricky Matthews on Super Talk Mississippi.
Welcome back to Super Talk Outdoors. I have my friend Reed Guice with me. He's an accomplished fly fisherman, and we're going to talk about tying some flies and just continue the conversation. But before we do that, I want to tell you a quick little story about Reed. Reed reads a lot. He reads so much. And back when I was publisher of the Sun Herald, we'd go to lunch and he would share various books with me. You know, it might be Steinbeck, might be Ernest Hemingway. I mean, he just has a great love of so many of the great authors. But he turned me on to Ernest Hemingway. And since then, I've read literally everything that Ernest Hemingway has written. And then I turned my son Justin on to Ernest Hemingway. In particular, the book The Sun Also Rises, which was written in 1926. And of course, there's a lot in that book. But one of the things in that book was these expatriates from Britain and America go over from Paris to the Festival of San Fermín in Pamplona, which is, as most people know, that's where the running with the bulls, the official running with the bulls in Spain is. My son goes to Madrid to learn Spanish. He moves to Madrid to learn Spanish and decides by himself to go pursue this memory of Ernest Hemingway's and goes over to San Fermín and runs with the bull and in Dead Man's Corner almost gets gored by a bull. And from this point forward, I have always said that my friend Reed Guice almost killed my son. But it's a great story, and Justin had a great time. But boy, you know, we've read some adventures together through our reading, haven't we?
Oh, absolutely. It's wonderful. Man, oh man. Well, what an accomplishment though to put check that off on a bucket list, right? Yeah, Ramblin' Bulls. That's pretty
cool. But went over there by himself, and you know, by the way, he gets there and he meets some locals, and he's not there with the tourists who are running. He gets up in the front of the pack and runs with the locals in the front of the pack, and it was just an amazing experience. But hey, Reed, so we're going to talk a little bit about some of the flies that you've tied.
Yeah.
Here's one, and for the radio audience, you can describe what this is. But this is special because you used some deer that we had killed to make this. What is this?
Yeah, so I would call that's a big-eyed deceiver designed by Lefty Cray. And it's just a type of tying. You can tie it in all sorts of different colors. It's a method, if you will. And it utilizes deer hair. That's where we had the bucktails from the kids that, you know, that took the does last year. And in the center of it, it's got some long white saddle hackles, or any color saddle hackle, depending on what color you want it. Here's I think I have another one sitting around here someplace. I've tied recently. Someplace. I got all sorts of flies around here. Oh, here's one I tied. Another deceiver.
Yeah. So describe to the radio audience what they're looking at.
Okay. What you got here is there we go. Let me put some light on it. Come here, guy.
Yeah. Yeah.
Light. Some light. Okay. So this is in the center, we have some green dyed saddle hackle. And on both the top and the bottom, it's surrounded by bucktail. And that bucktail keeps the feathers from wrapping around the hook and messing you up. You know, something like that happens, you're not going to catch a fish. So it's really a design. And there's some crystal stuff in the middle of it there to make it all flashy. And if you'll see on right under the eye here, under the eye of the hook.
Yeah.
You see that monofilament?
Yes.
Put that on there as sort of a weed guard. If I'm fishing like at Chandelier, where we have all the grass, or someplace when there's, if you're out fishing the grass in a tide rip, that will keep the grass from getting onto the fly.
Yeah.
So it's a design. I tell you, most of the flies that I use here in the Sound and in Gulf of Mexico are called the Clouser Minna. And the color is a chartreuse and white. It's got a lead head on it, like sort of like a jig, and chartreuse on the top, bucktail and white bucktail on the bottom, and a lot of flash in there. I was wondering how often I use this, and I just happened to take a look at I have a half a dozen rods here that are in various sizes. We're speckled trout, 6, 7, 8, redfish, 9 weight, 8, 9, 10, and for tarpon and cobia, I have 12 weights. I looked at what kind of fly. Every rod has got a chartreuse and white Clouser Minna on it, and just in different sizes. It is absolutely the most deadly fly out there. And it's all subsurface.
This is what's interesting too, and of course we don't have time to get into all these details, but there's a lot of art to it, man. I mean, when you get done tying a fly, you almost don't want to use it. You want to frame it so you can appreciate it. But it is art, isn't it?
Well, it's the joy of doing something with your hands, and the anticipation while you're tying it. And when you take that fly and you put it in your box, and when you actually catch a fish on a fly that you've tied, that's a heck of an accomplishment.
Yeah.
David wasn't a big tier, but once we were on a skipjack in the Florida Keys, tarpon fishing, we had a guide come pick us up at the boat, and I had my fly tying stuff on board, and David tied a fly with a rabbit hair tail, a rabbit strip, and a palmered hackle around the top of it. And the first fly he ever caught, he landed in the corner of the mouth of a 100-pound tarpon. And left it there, got it to the boat, and instead of trying to unhook it and gaff it, just kind of broke it off when it got close to the boat. It's a real thrill.
And, what a great memory. My friend Chris Gertz, who's the secretary for the foundation, is a sponsor of the show. His father, Chris Gertz Sr., has tagged more blackfish in the Gulf of Mexico than anyone. Unfortunately, God bless him, he passed away a couple of years ago. But Chris gave this to me. It's kind of a popper. How do you describe this? But see, I'll probably never use this. It's just such a special piece. But how would you describe that?
It looks to me like it's articulated because it goes up and down. They call that articulated. And then the front of it would stay in up in the surface film, but the bottom of that would actually be in the water. So you got sort of a damp fly, if you will. And
yeah.
I can see where a triple tail would eat that thing up to pieces.
You got any big adventures that you're about to go on?
I do.
Where are you headed?
I'm going next to the Deschutes River in Oregon, and for a specific hatch. We have a stonefly hatch there that begins in May, and the fish go crazy over them. These are big, big, big bugs. Let me show you one. This is the bug that we'd be fishing with trout with. I mean, that's a monster, isn't it?
It's about an inch and a half.
Oh yeah, it's a number four hook.
Yeah.
For a trout, that's huge. That's the salmon fly.
Yeah.
They have another stone fly that hatches, that is called the golden stone, and this is a golden stone here. You can see it's just tied the same way. It's just different color, different size. A lot of those fish are caught subsurface because these stone flies, they don't hatch in the water. They go towards the shore and they crawl up rocks. So you throw up close to the rocks with some big, ugly thing like this.
Yeah.
They love it. I mean, they just eat them to pieces. I'm really excited about that.
So you can go, if you want to see what some of these flies look like, you can go to the SuperTalk Outdoors Facebook page or go to the SuperTalk Outdoors YouTube page. And I think you'll enjoy seeing what I believe is just literally works of art. But, you know, coming back to coastal Mississippi, Reed, it's pretty awesome that you can go in your backyard, get in a boat, take your flies and go to somewhere like, for example, Ship Island this time of year and catch bull reds. I mean, it's hard to beat that, isn't it?
It's what I live for. And I'm so disturbed about how poor the weather has been. My brother, who's the ship's captain, whenever he's off the ship, he wants to get on a boat and go catch redfish out there. And you can go out to the barrier islands this time of year and wade and sight cast to bull reds, schools of them. And yes, that's what I live for. It's that time of year. And look, but the Mother Nature is just not cooperating. We've been out three times and been successful all three times. But by now, it's going to finish up really in March. The fish leave there and they go out into the middle of the Gulf, you know, and get in schools out there. So we don't have much time left.
What I love about the Gulf, and I say it here, especially when I have my charter boat friends on the show, is that you can leave, and I say you leave with 10 battle plans. You're really not sure. You know, your destination may be the horseshoe rig, but you may stop very short of that because you find, you know, this sargasm grass out in the middle of nowhere and end up staying there all day. But, Reed, we're out of time. It has been a pleasure to catch up with you, my friend.
Oh, great. Thank you. Nice to visit with you too, Ricky. Thank you so much for having me.
It's been great. We'll have you back. You know, fly fishing. I think a lot of people in Mississippi love fly fishing. Hey, when we come back, we're going to have Nicole Smith, and we're going to talk about some upcoming events. We'll see you after this.
We live in one of the best places in America to enjoy the outdoors.
So let's talk about it.
It's Super Talk Outdoors with Ricky Matthews on Super Talk Mississippi. It's cut through walls and fall
football. A Gulf Coast. Welcome back to Super Talk Outdoors. I really enjoyed that conversation with Reed Guice. There are so many people from all walks of life who have so many great stories to tell about their time in the outdoors here in Mississippi. Now let's turn the page and move over to my friend, Crystal Nicole Smith. Nicole, how are you doing?
I'm great. How are you, Ricky?
I'm doing great. Nicole is a project specialist, an event planner, let's put it that way, at the Mississippi Museum of Natural Science in Jackson. And we've invited her to join us today to tell us about upcoming events. But before we do that, just how are you doing in general?
I'm great. The new year has definitely gotten started with a bang, so it's been good.
So, hey, tell us, how did January go so far, just in general? How are things at the museum?
Oh, it's wonderful. It's been action-packed. So we had to pack up the NASA exhibit, and that was mind-bogglingly huge, so that took a minute. We are unpacking and establishing the new exhibit from here to there, and that's going to be opening to the public this Saturday, January 28th, and it's all physics, it's playful, it's interactive. You can get in a hovercraft and, like, you know, see what that's like. It's about transportation, but it's also about Newton's laws, and it's very kid friendly. So whether you're 6 years old or, 66, I think you're going to have something to get out of this one. It's a lot of fun.
From here to there, it seems like a complex unpacking, though.
Yeah, there's lots of parts to it, but it's just so playful. Like, I think everyone's going to love this, and it meets all of our science standards, too. So if you're a teacher looking for a great field trip, it's wonderful for that. If you are a parent who's looking for, like, extra enrichment for your child, like, it's going to be great for that. Like, there's a lot to love about it. And it starts Saturday and it goes on till about May the 7th. So there's going to be a lot to enjoy about that. And there's events happening while it's here, too. So, like, the next one is Mississippi's Arbor Day. Did you know Mississippi had its very own Arbor Day?
There you go.
Yeah, we do. So there's a national Arbor Day, but we have ours here in the spring. It's going to be Friday, the 10th of February, and it's called STEM Leaves and Trees because we think we're funny. It's a STEM event. It's going to be fun. And we're going to have saplings to give away. So if you need some saplings for your property, just come on to that event. It's going to be from 9 till noon that day, and we've got guided nature hikes, so you can learn to identify trees. Ag Museum's going to be here with the Uncle Story Puppet doing a story time called A Log's Life. We'll be doing log dissections. We'll be learning about germination. I mean, it's a whole thing. It's going to be amazing. So you don't want to miss that. And it's a Friday, so it's a good field trip opportunity. If you're a homeschool family, you want to come on and yeah, not to be missed. And if you've got property, come and get some saplings. So it all comes with admission. Or if you're a member already, it's free. So it's definitely worth your time.
So looking forward, what else is on your to-do list?
Oh, boy. Okay. Sorry, I get excited because I love what I do. On March the 10th is our Science Makers event. And that is our celebration of women and minorities who are just killing it in the STEM fields, doing amazing things in Mississippi STEM industry. So we've got guests that are going to be doing things on forestry. We've got some that are going to be doing DNA extraction experiments. We're going to demonstrations. It's very engaging. That one's also, these are like the field trip events. That one's also going to be on a Friday, like that morning. So not to be missed. It's great to see what's happening here in Mississippi and a girl power. It's going to be great.
That's in March. What else?
Oh boy. Our birthday. That's Nature Fest. That's April 1st. No fooling. It's our birthday, April 1st. And it's going to be from noon till 5 this year. It's the first time ever we've done it that way, but that's because they rented the park that morning for a different event. So you want to save the date, Nature Fest. It's got, it's kind of like an open house, early Earth Day, museum birthday celebration. We use the whole campus for it. We might have, I'm still working on what the program's going to be, but in the past we've had Freedom Ranch with their wildlife show programs. We've had musicians. We've had magicians too. We do guided nature hikes, the behind the scenes tours. We've had a lot with Nature Fest in the past, and we're figuring out what it looks like for this year too. So always follow us on Facebook. You're going to see the 13,000 things that we're doing at any given moment. So it's not to be missed.
So as I like to say about you, no rest for the weary. But, the Mississippi Museum of Natural Science has such an important place to role to play in Mississippi. And it's people like Nicole Smith, who's an event planner there. It's people like her that's making sure that this happens in a big way. The next time we talk, Nicole, we're kind of out of time now, but the next time we talk, the emergence of STEM and the relationship between that and the museum has created this great educational link that will forever be, an empowered role that the museum can play. And I know you're super excited about that. So we'll talk about the STEM part of that in the future. How about we do that?
That sounds great. And I do want to make a note of that. Follow us on Facebook, Mississippi Museum of Natural Science. See all the STEM stuff we're doing. We're all STEM all the time. We are a science museum. You know, it's not a fad. It's been around forever. We're just like highlighting it in new ways. And then follow us on our website too, the Mississippi Department of Wildlife, Fisheries, and Parks, and you can see what we're up to.
Have a great day. Thank you.
Thank you.